ESPN 97.7 WREF, Seabury, Henderson, and Evansville. ESPN 97.7 The Ref.
WREF 97.7 FM. ESPN Radio presents the 1982 Castle Football Reunion Show. This show was brought to you by Castle Athletics, Chapman Injury and Lawyers, Gilkey Cairo and Sports, and by Jimmy John's. This special show featuring the 1982 Castle State Championship football team is also brought to you by Jimmy John's, Lawnmasters of Newburgh, Newburgh Auto Parts, by Primetime Pub and Grill, and by the Rooster's Den. Now live from Castle High School, here is your host, Gene Worrell.
Good afternoon, folks, and welcome to Castle High School. We're here in the cafeteria. And, yeah, the school was closed today, but, hey, man, when you got a 40th reunion going on for the 1982 Castle State football team, yeah, the show goes on. And we're here, and the game's going on tonight between Castle and Bosse. It's going to be a great night here for 2 hours here on the Ref. Glad to have you here. Hey, I hope you're having a great beginning to your Labor Day weekend. I don't know if you're going out to the Corn Ferry Tour or whatever you're doing, if you're smoking ribs or butts or whatever, enjoy yourself and make it a great Labor Day weekend here this 2022. Hey, we got a great show tonight. I mean, I couldn't hardly sleep last night, man. We got all the guys here tonight. We're going to start off with Neil Chapman and Mike Davis. He's on the phone with us. He's calling from California. Then we're going to Rodney Russell and Mike Hoag, Kenny Brown, Craig Boudet. They're going to give us a shout-out. Coach Johnny Evers and Marc Anderson, coaches there from that team. David Brosmer. We got the Brosmer boys. We got David and Chris, and I'm really looking forward to that because I got a lot of questions for them, not about football but some other stuff. And then Deon Chester, he's going to give us a shout-out, and Greg Seibert. But the 40th reunion of the 1982 Castle State Football Championship, and these guys were bad dudes. I mean, they came into that Hobart game 13-0, both of them did, and ended up 14-0. And Mike Davis, brother, are you out there in California? Are you with us?
Hey, I am, and I'd like to start by thanking you. This is awesome. It's great to be part of this. My only regret. And sorry, Neil, I got to get this in there. My only regret is I'm not there in person, so I don't get to see Neil's what he's wearing today, because there's no doubt this is the most dapper guy in the Castle Knights history.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and tell you, Davis. I mean, I'm looking at him right here, and he's got it's some fancy T-shirt on. He's got the six-pack abs. He's got his hair waxed down. I mean, is that typical of Chapman?
That's it. Thank you. I got the visual now. I'm ready to go.
Okay. So you know I've got the guy here, right? So, Neil, all right, so we've already gave you the introduction. Davis, I mean, he's out there in California, long way to go. I know you're a lawyer. I mean, can you do anything about that with the California laws or anything?
We've been trying to get Michael Davis to come back home for 30 years now.
Right.
Maybe more.
Right.
Well, bless his heart. You know what?
I'm always home, Neil.
You know what that really means, right?
No. Well, no.
In
no.
Texas.
No, okay, this is a radio show. It's a family show, right? So we got Neil Chapman, and Neil was a senior fullback. And from what my notes say, and Mike, and you can just, this is what it says, he's the smartest guy on the team.
That's fair. That's fair. I was in a math class with him once, and that was the last time I did that.
But wait a minute. Okay, I'm not the guy that became Microsoft's top man in Vietnam for several years like Michael Davis did in
right.
the 1990s, or become a chief executive officer in Silicon Valley Software. But now we're talking too much about the present.
Right.
We need to talk more about the past.
Right. But but Mike, you were a senior quarterback, and you went to Louisville actually in college, and a fact that I didn't know, and I want to thank Pat Lockyer for kind of helping with all this information. You never lost a game as a quarterback from sixth grade to your senior year. Is that true?
That is technically true. Yeah, it is. I missed a game in seventh grade, and that was a game that the team lost. And some people might say, you know, that I'm trying to brag here by saying it's because I wasn't there, but maybe I was just smart enough not to show up. But that is true. I did not lose a game as a starting quarterback.
Well, and you know, you were the and apparently they called you Magic Mike. Is this correct or not?
I probably heard that a few times, yeah.
Let's go to Neil Chapman. Chapman, is that right or not?
No, that's just what the ladies called him.
Oh, that's what the ladies called him.
You know, I got a question for Michael. Man, do you ever dream about being in a football game? You know, you're in this dream and you're thinking you're back in football and you're quarterback and all that. You have those dreams, right?
I have those dreams.
I bet. Yeah, so do I. Of course, I'm not the quarterback, but. Question: when you're dreaming, are you at Castle High School playing high school ball, or are you at the University of Louisville playing college ball?
Oh, no question, Castle, no question. In fact, I've even had a dream where I showed up and they told me I was too old to play again. So yeah, I had those dreams.
Right. Well, we got Mike Davis from he's calling from out there in Northern California. Neil Chapman here, senior fullback. And one of our sponsors, Chapman Injury Lawyers. But guys, you know, you look at that season, and man, you ran the tables. You went 14-0, and you outscored your opponents, 401-76, including four shutouts. So, Mike, I mean, I know you and Neil are kind of on the offensive side, but man, that defense was something there in 1982.
Yeah, terribly tough defense. And I know Neil would agree. Like, you know, these guys were shutting folks down. And it certainly made our job a heck of a lot easier knowing that, if you do happen to throw an interception, you got a chance of getting the ball back. And there were a couple games where without that, you know, we wouldn't be sitting at 14-0.
Can we talk about Joe Huff for a second? Okay.
Sure.
Joe was such a hyper-competitive guy. There were a lot of competitive guys on our team.
Right.
The Brosmer brothers, are you kidding me?
Yeah. They still are.
Yes, nothing's changed.
Right.
But Joe Huff might have even been a notch above that. For example, every practice we ever had, before we did anything, Lighty would tell us to take a lap around the baseball backstop. It was what, Michael, half a mile or something? And on a hot dog day of summer. And most of us just go out there and jog it to warm up. Not Joe Huff. He would be number one every time on that warm-up lap. And there were a couple of guys on the team, Michael Davis being one of them, could actually beat him. Mike was like an 800-meter state champion, as I recall. But nobody wanted to engage him before practice because Huff was going to beat you. He was just a stone-cold killer, that guy. Remember in fifth grade? See, we go back to fifth and sixth grade. Michael and Joe Huff and I were the same team.
Well, that's where that team actually started, right?
Yep, Newburgh Raiders. And I remember that game when Joe Huff intercepted, he was on defense, he intercepted a handoff from the opposing quarterback.
That's that question.
And I remember looking,
yeah.
Is that allowed? Can you intercept a handoff? Now, granted, this is like we were 11 years old, but that's, of course, Joe went on to, Hawaii, break the record of tackles at IU, I believe, and win IU's first bowl game his senior year, I believe, with the Holiday Bowl, maybe.
Yeah, it was.
Just reminded me, Neil, of a story back in the day, Joe Huff climbing a tetherball pole before practice. Got his finger caught up in the top of that pole and literally almost tore it off and then went ahead and practiced anyway.
What the heck was he doing climbing a tether pole?
I don't know.
Neil, that's because he could.
Right.
Well, Mike Davis, Neil Chapman here, two seniors on that 1982 championship team. Sorry, so you guys, that Hobart game, you won it 26-23. Brosmer, he had a great game, and then you had Mike. You did that that hook and ladder deal with Deon and Brosmer there, like you did it in the Martinsville game, and it seemed like everything was clicking for you guys that whole year, and because I'll tell you what, I mean, I'm looking at the records. As for since 1960 from Castle, and man, you guys really started coming alive right there around 1980 and so forth. And apparently, this was like I was telling Neil here just a minute ago. You had some Chandler, the Chandler guys. Of course, Lockyer went to Chandler, but they this was a special team in the works for a few years.
Oh, for sure, for sure. And you know, I think we had the benefit of working with each other, playing together for a whole bunch of years there, right? And you know, one of the favorite stories I like to tell on that front is, you know, we had run the same plays, same offense together for so long that I remember one practice in particular where we started running the plays backwards. And of course, you know, the coach has got a kick out of that and would then sort of show us off, and visitors would show up, have us run the plays backwards. But that was the benefit of being together for so many years and working closely.
I forgot how well-oiled we were. Someone posted, they shared the Boonville game, which I guess was about this time. It was September 2nd, I believe, in 1982.
Right, when you won 52-0.
Yeah, at home.
Right.
And my God, it just wasn't a game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Davis was flawless. Hit every pass except one, because he threw it just barely over my head, and apparently I didn't think it was important enough to jump up to catch it.
Right.
I don't know. But that was about the only pass that wasn't caught.
Did you guys, you know, when you got in the huddle, Mike and Neil, was there ever a time when the play came in and it's like, I don't know if we want to run that. Did you kind of overrule the coach and call something different?
I don't remember that. And if I did, I probably wouldn't admit it.
You never did that.
So basically you were scared.
Probably.
Is that right, Neil, or?
Probably. I will say this. I will say this. For the Carmel game, Coach Evers, brilliant strategy. Saw some tendencies on the defensive side of Carmel and teed us up with a play that we could check to, and actually, you know, had the nerve to put that in our hands and put that in my hands in particular to be able to check out of the play when we saw them in the right alignment. And it worked like a charm. We pulled it off right down by the end zone about 8 yards out, and Chris broke off the right tackle and scored a touchdown.
Well, you know, John Leidy was like, he was right out of the 1950s. I don't think, you know, the Cultural Revolution never happened,
right,
in John Leidy's head. He was a crew cut, right? Army, U.S. Army,
yep,
issue. I think he was a major in the Army Reserve, had a heck of a Army career. So, and he was quietly confident. He allowed his assistant coaches to be really fantastic and intellectual in their own
right. Oh, absolutely.
I mean, Evers, Anderson, Sims, those guys were the brain trust. But they didn't threaten Leidy at all. Leidy had his role as the head coach, and allowed them to
be a true team coaches buy-in.
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember little Vince Leidy, who at the time was barely old enough to walk around with a football. He didn't know how to hold it right. He held the football up and down. His arm wasn't long enough in our locker.
Yeah.
Of course, 12 years after our state championship, he was the starting quarterback and middle linebacker to win another state championship. But Vince Leidy, little Vince, had the same high and tight, flat top haircut as his dad did.
Well, and Mike, you know, we got a few minutes left, but it's been brought to my attention that Neil might have maybe skipped a practice, something to go to a concert. I mean, do you recall that?
So. No, because, well, I didn't know until years later. I mean, Neil was smart, right? He was smart enough not to tell us, because we would have absolutely pummeled him, right? And I literally found out, I think it was after high school, years later, he told me, and I wanted to pummel him then.
Dumbest thing I ever did.
So what happened?
What happened? The truth?
Yeah. So Neil, what happened there, buddy?
Well, I didn't explain it till the book. Tom Wilder, the writer, came to me and wanted something to put in the book. And, you know, I wanted the book to be something new and different. And I told the truth that I was a huge rock and roll fan, and my favorite band was The Who, right, the classic British rock band. And they just announced their world farewell tour. And my buddy, this buddy who was not on the football team, decidedly the other type of pothead guy, had tickets, great tickets, and offered them to me.
So where was it at?
Louisville. Okay. And it was the night before the big game at Memorial. Both of our teams were coming in undefeated. What, 6-0? It was halfway through the season. Each team undefeated at 6-0. Huge game. And probably the worst judgment I've ever used in my entire life. I decided I told Coach Leidy. I lied to the coach.
Right.
And you know, that's not me. I said, my stomach's upset. I just can't do this practice. I went to the concert instead.
Right.
The next day, Coach asked me if I was okay before the game. I said, I'm fine, so he let me start anyway. And in the first half, I went off sides, and it called the play back. We went into the locker room behind 6-0. And I was hating myself. I thought I'd let down my team,
right,
my coach, my family.
Because they ended up 33-6.
Right. And I think I even there was a go-ahead touchdown. We did a reverse 47 pass. I think I scored the go-ahead touchdown. We put on a few more touchdowns. So I got to vindicate myself. But, boy, oh, boy, I was sweating. And you know, you should always remember
for more reasons than one.
you know what they say? You should always forget your failures and your mistakes in life and try to dwell on your victories. But what do you think I remember? Do you think I remember scoring the go-ahead touchdown that game, or do you think I remember going off sides because I was, like, hung over from a loud rock concert the night before? So, I remember that being at halftime thinking my world was over and I'd let everyone down and I wanted to die. That's what I remember.
Mike, is that the way you remember it?
No, I don't remember that.
That's why he's a lawyer right now.
Exactly.
Kids, for everyone listening out there, don't be like me. Don't lie to your coach.
Did you listen to The Who prior to that game?
Oh, yeah. I had all their albums.
Well, you had to.
Of course.
Right.
And I still do. I've seen them 12 times since.
All right. One last question here. Mike, so you're out there in California now. Tell us what you're doing, brother.
Hey, so, you know, I've got a family out here. My three girls. My oldest is actually starting her second year at Cal Berkeley. She's a swimmer. And then I have two seniors who are also swimmers, two girls, and they're looking to swim in college too. And my wife and I just hang out and be proud of those guys.
That's awesome. Neil?
Right. Yeah, it's like Mike, I'm blessed with daughters.
Right.
I have a 30-year-old who's getting married in November. She's an optometrist, went to IU Optometry School, and my youngest daughter is 23, and she's back home now after being in college in Los Angeles. And my wife and I are living on the east side of Evansville.
Right.
And, of course, I've had my practice. I'm 28 years of practicing law and my injury law firm since 2008. So
that's great.
I got partners now, and I really enjoy what I do and happy to be here. And thank you for having us on.
Yeah. Man. Well, listen, guys, we're going to take a quick time out. We got to get Rodney Russell and Mike Hoag on here. But, Mike, God bless you. Appreciate you giving us a shout-out here from California. Of course, Neil, glad you could join in. So appreciate it, guys.
Hey, thank you. Thanks for including me. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right,
so much fun.
We're going to take a quick time out. This is the 1982 Castle State Football Championship 43 Union right here on the Ref on this Labor Day weekend, 2022. Glad to have you. Chapman Law, located in downtown Evansville, is a personal injury firm serving Indiana, Kentucky, and Illinois. Chapman offers cases that aren't won by the degrees and diplomas on our walls. Cases are won with hard work, dedication, and attention to detail. Our results speak for themselves. Chapman Law will earn our clients respect by how we treat them on the way to getting those results. Chapman Law in downtown Evansville. For further information, hit them up at 812-426-0600 or visit their website at chapmanlaw.com. Gilkey Chiropractic Clinic is a chiropractic clinic located at 7580 Peachwood Drive in Newburgh, Indiana. They specialize in chiropractic care, active release techniques, physical therapy, massage therapy, therapeutic exercise, and nutrition as a drug-free approach to wellness. Gilkey is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics and wishes all teams great success in the brand new year. Gilkey Chiropractic in Newburgh. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-2997 or visit their website at gilkeychiropractic.com.
Jimmy John's. They'll make your sandwiches exactly the way you want them because you're the one who's eating it. Tasty sandwiches made fresh when you order. Place an online order for pickup or delivery. Order your favorite Jimmy John's sandwiches to cater your next business or special event. Made fresh to order on their fresh baked bread using hand-sliced meats and fresh veggies. They'll feed as few or as many as you need. Party boxes, box lunches, and mini Jimmys are totally customizable. And don't forget to grab bags of Jimmy Chips, buckets of Jumbo Kosher Pickle Spears, and chocolate chip or oatmeal raisin cookies for the whole crew. Jimmy John's. Online ordering and freaky fast delivery. Visit your local Jimmy John's today.
Since 2007, Lawn Masters of Newburgh is the go-to company for mole patrol and lawn seeding. Additional services include flea and tick control treatments that will keep fleas, ticks, and chiggers out of your lawn. Need proof? Check out the Castle High School softball field, one of the most beautiful natural grass fields in the tri-state. Call Lawn Masters of Newburgh for all your commercial or residential lawn care needs, or visit them online at yourlawnmasters.com. Lawn Masters of Newburgh. Be happy with your lawn.
Napa Auto Parts is your local auto parts store that stocks auto parts, tools, and equipment, and many other items for heavy-duty trucks, marine, and farming equipment. Located at 4966 Highway 66 East in Newburgh, they are open Monday through Friday from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturdays from 8 to 3. They're a big supporters of Castle Athletics, in which the 1982 state football champions, a great 40th anniversary and reunion. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-0433 or visit their website at NapaOnline.com.
People's Bank is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Serving the area for over 125 years, People's is committed to solving problems and creating opportunities for each and every one of our customers. Come see us at one of our four locations in Boonville, Newburgh, and our newest branch on North Green River Road in Evansville. Ask about our gold checking account, our Main Street mortgage, or any of our other services. People's Bank. Friendly. Hometown. Banking. Online at www.peoplestrust.bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender, NMLS 229852.
Are you looking for a local high-end sports bar with great food and a fun bar? Then you're looking for Primetime Pub and Grill in Newburgh. You will love their relaxing atmosphere, excellent food, friendly service, and pet-friendly patio. Primetime Pub and Grill offers 24 drafts, 34 bourbons, and a nice selection of wines and other spirits, and now offers brunch on Saturdays and Sundays from 10 until 2. Primetime provides unforgettable food, including great half-pound burgers, fast appetizer choices, steak salads, and, of course, prime rib. Follow them on Instagram and Facebook or browse their online menus at PrimetimeNewburgh.com.
The Rooster's Den is your local hometown spot to get all your favorite foods here in Newburgh, Indiana, now open for breakfast and lunch. Located here on Haley Drive, they are open Tuesday through Saturday from 6 a.m. to 2 and Sundays from 7 a.m. to 2. Hey, get all your great stuff, your biscuits and gravy, your waffles, all your great stuff, and they're a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Rooster's Den offers dine-in or carry-out. Hit them up at 812-706-3555 or visit their website at roostersdennewburgh.com.
Welcome back to the 1982 Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion. Live from Castle High School in the cafeteria right here on the ref. Gene World here. Glad to have you. Corey Clayton, our great producer, back at the station. Hey, happy Labor Day weekend as we're kicking off this 2022 season here on the Labor Day side. And hope you're doing well wherever you're at. And we got high school football tonight. We're going to have the Jasper Wrights game. After the show, Ryan Metzger and Josh Woody will send you up to the bowl there at Wrights High School. Hey, how about our Castle reunion football show sponsors, Castle Athletics, Chapman Injury Lawyers, Gilkey Cairo and Sports, Jimmy John's, Lawn Masters of Newburgh, Newburgh Auto Parts, People's Bank, Primetime Pub and Grill.
Did you turn your phone on?
And the Rooster's Den.
Yeah.
So we've got two more players here. And on deck is going to be Kenny Brown and Craig Boudet, both seniors. Kenny was a tight end. Boudet was a defensive back. But right now we've got Rodney Russell. And Rodney was a linebacker and a guard. And Mike Hoag. And Mike is here. So, guys, 40 years.
Yeah.
That's a long dang time, right?
Oh, my gosh.
It's a long time, but it seems like yesterday at times.
Does it really?
Yeah. Yeah, it really does.
So both you guys are seniors, and I mean, you had a of course, undefeated year and so forth, but unbelievable year.
Oh, it was amazing. I mean, I remember playing we were little kids playing on the side of the hill when I think it was the Castle of Greenville. Is that right?
Greenfield. Yep.
And we'd, you know, wrestle, run up and down the hill, playing and stuff, and we'd watch the game and. You know, that game when they got beat there at the end, but it was just like a seed in our hearts, thinking, man, one day we could be like that. You know, it was something we looked up to, you know, saying,
right.
man, that would be awesome playing a state championship football game, you know, one day and be state champs of Indiana.
Right, definitely. You know, I think that we certainly grew up through those years idolizing those teams in the middle 70s that were really good teams, and the 75 team, 76 teams were very good teams. And obviously we did very well in those early years. And then as we got into high school and, you know, Castle had transitioned from 3A.
Right.
It was a struggle for a number of years, and we saw them lose, and we stood on the sidelines. And mm-hmm. while we were winning some of our games at our level, we saw the varsity struggling, and that was difficult to watch. But I think, like Mike said, it planted a seed in us to want to continue to work hard and strive to do the best that we could.
We're talking with Rodney Russell and Mike Hoag here, two members of that 1982 Castle State Football Championship at this 40th reunion. And like you said, Rodney, and I mean, you guys, they were 10-1 in, 75?
Yeah.
Then they went 7-3, and you guys went 6-4, then in 78, you had an 0 spot, 0-10.
Yeah.
And then 1-9, but the resurgence really started like in 80, because you guys were, 6-3, 80, 10-3 in 81, then of course 82, the magical 14-0 year.
Yeah.
So that's when you guys really started making a run. And and you know, you made a great point, Mike. I mean, you know, when you were younger, did you, you know, you started getting, you know, the guys from Chandler with like Lockyer and so forth, but did you kind of feel something special maybe? Because this happens a lot, man. Mm-hmm. If you get, you know, younger kids, like they're sixth graders or whatever, and they got this team, you know, they know it could be special once they get to high school. But was that kind of a feeling back then or not?
Well, the thing about us was that, you know, me, Rodney, Bros, Davis, we were like a nucleus. We were inseparable. We spent the night, I mean, at each other's houses on the weekends. We played pool ball during the summer. I mean, we were... I don't know if you guys have ever played pool ball. It's like baseball in a swimming pool. Davis had the most awesome setup, but we would play all day. We grew together. We knew each other's instincts.
Right.
We knew if he was going right or left. I mean, we just, you know, I was surrounded by a great group of guys. You know, I didn't have the greatest home life, but Rodney was like my brother. I mean, we just surrounded each other. We knew each other like the back of our hands. They changed my life because, you know, there's no telling what direction I would have ever gone if I didn't have them in my life. But they made me a better person. They just are a great group of guys to this day. But we did things all summer. We hung out. We played pool ball. We played overline. We played basketball. Ultimate frisbee. We were always doing stuff together. And it was just an awesome experience.
Yeah, I think we fed off each other a lot, and, you know, we pushed each other all the time to be the best person we could be, the best athlete we could be, the best, you know, student we could be, and so we wanted people, I think, to look up to us, and we didn't try to do that, but that was just part of the nature of us, really, to do that, and, you know, our senior year, I can remember Mike and I going out and doing extra things after weightlifting. We'd go out and we'd push his car after weightlifting in the parking lot, and we'd have a guy put the brake on a little bit, and it just, your legs would be burning like you could imagine. But we went the extra mile to do the things we needed to do. We got together as a group. You know, football is so different today than it was back then. You didn't get together early on when the summer started. We got together as a group on our own. Coaches weren't there. We ran a lot of skeleton-type passing and defensive perimeter drills, and we get the guys out and run it. And I think that's the reason we did so well defensively and we were so good offensively with throwing the football. And obviously we ran a lot of misdirection because we didn't have the size a lot of the other teams.
Well, that misdirection, I mean, you guys ran it perfectly. And, of course, Davis, the quarterback, was
the magician.
He was excellent at faking and so forth. Yeah. But, I mean, man, you look at these, you know, about the first six games. Yeah, I mean, you had four shutouts.
Yeah.
And was there a point there, guys, when it's you kind of get maybe midseason, I mean, you're undefeated, that maybe, hey, we think we can make a run here?
You know, I personally, I don't think we ever really thought that way. Gene, because I think that us as a group, we all, I think we felt like that we couldn't be beat. But we didn't think we would just win every game out. I think we went through the process, and we tackled it in one step at a time. And, you know, that's just the kind of people we were. We weren't braggarts. We didn't go around showboating. We didn't do any of that stuff. We did what we needed to do to be successful and at the end of the day.
You know, just like Rodney said, we had a dream, and the dream was we wanted to play in a state championship football game. We wanted to win it, and we did the extra stuff. Man, we used to go, I mean, like Rodney said, we go out and push cars. I used to deadlift cars, and we used to do stuff like that. It's crazy.
Right.
But I'm going to tell you right now, our legs were, I mean, I don't know if you ever pushed a car, and you do that, it burns.
Right.
And I tell you what, that was some of the best conditioning that we had. And those were the things that prepared us, because I'm 5'11", 200 pounds, blocking. You know, we were just talking about Herbie Stogsdale from Boonville. He's 6'8". He's a monster. But, sorry, Herb, but we blew him on the line.
Right.
That's why we were able to, you know, compensate our size with speed, strength, and, you know, we were smart.
What was a practice like? Back with Coach Spidey back in the day.
You know, it was a set schedule every day. He had it on the board. We knew what was coming each day. And I don't know if you remember this or not, Mike, but every in the summertime, he always had a senior pick at the end of practice, we had to pick what the conditioning was going to be. And so, you know, we had a lot of fun with that. It was a normal practice just like any other. But
remember the snake?
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, so what's that?
Well, go ahead, Roddy. You want me to tell?
You tell.
No, we would we all run, drop down, and hop over the next guy and keep doing that continuously. Right. It was fun, but I'm telling you right now, you wore your butt out. We go up and down hills like a big old snake all the way around.
Right.
But, I mean, we did all kinds of – you know, the thing is, we never stepped off the field. Offense and defense, we played both ways. I didn't want to be off the field. I knew if I was on that field with my motivation, my heart, we were going to win. There was no other place I wanted to be.
Well, and if you look at some of those games where you start seeing some scores against us, I don't think there was ever more than one touchdown that came against us until got into the playoffs.
Yeah, Martinsville.
Yeah, that was the first time it happened. But a lot of those scores that happened early in the regular season were the result of us coming off the field. They were on a kickoff return by another team, or we had maybe they pulled us at the end of the game because we were up by so much, and they had the JV go in. And so we didn't give up those touchdowns a lot of times, you know. So we could have gone into the playoffs probably only giving up maybe one score, maybe none.
Almost a competition? You know, I mean, the offense under Davis and the Brosmers and, of course, Deon and so forth. And Court Neal, it was like, you know, you guys want to kind of pull your way too, right? Defensive guys.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, we had so much pride in our defense, and you know, I think in the back of our minds, we didn't feel like we could be scored on, and we shouldn't have been.
Yeah.
And you know, if you look at the stats from that year, I think interception wise, I think we held the record for many years, and it may still be up there as one of the teams that had the most interceptions in a season. Now, we played a lot of games,
right,
but we had a lot of interceptions. So, you know, but each guy had a unique skill set on that team. And, you know, we just gelled so well together as a group. We communicated very well, and everybody knew their parts, and they played them. Nobody tried to outdo or outshine the other guy.
Plus, our coaching staff was awesome. I mean, I remember they used to give us these books and notes, and we'd study and prepare. I mean, it wasn't just a game. We had a mission. And the mission was to be a state champ. And I tell you what, we wanted to shut people down. We didn't want them scoring. That was pride, man. Somebody scored. Rodney chewed my butt out if I failed, and I'd chew his butt out. So we held each other accountable. And we expect nothing but the best. And that's why we work so hard in conditioning. During the second half, if we were close, you know, some of the games are close. Second half, we blew them out because of our conditioning.
Yeah.
You know,
you know, we were dog tired after the game, but I tell you right now, we were in good condition. We were well prepared. Our coaching staff was awesome.
Well, that night is to kind of refresh your memory, and I've watched the game twice. The great Jerry Baker, it was on WTTV. I watched it on YouTube, but it's like 50 degrees that night, and it was like a rain. It was windy, yeah. And is that in North Central?
Yeah.
I mean, the worst conditions ever. I mean, not ever, but they weren't ideal. But you guys came out. Brosmers scored right off the bat, 7-0, and then they Hobart had a 52-yard pass, and then David Brosmer caught another pass, and it was 27 at halftime. So real quick, do you remember what happened at halftime when you came in and Coach Leidy? I mean, what did he tell the boys?
Well, I'll tell you, we were surprised because we were kicking their butts. I mean, it was almost like, what the heck? This is supposed to be a lot harder. Huge guys. I mean, they were a good team. But because of our conditioning, being prepared, and we were just on top of the world. We had our goal, and it was right there. And it was, like, so easy. So it was kind of like a letdown. They kind of came back there. Because we were just like, well, what the heck's going on here? This is too easy.
Well, actually, they took a lead 23-20.
Yeah, so, you know, and then I think we went back ahead. Might have been the flea flicker that we called it the flea flicker. It was basically the hook and ladder.
Hook and ladder, right.
Bros scored on it. And, you know, we scored on that play, I think, three times that season. We scored against Memorial. We scored against
Martinsville. Martinsville's a big one.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. But again, I think we got a little bit conservative in the second half of that game, to be honest. And,
we did.
And we played down to it, and we probably should have just kept the pedal to the metal and kept going. And, you know, who knows what happened. It didn't matter in the end. We obviously won, and that's all that mattered. But I remember Pat and I kind of looking at each other at that halftime, and that's one of the things that stuck out to him. I don't really remember a whole lot about what the coaches said, but Pat and I were just dog tired. And, you know, I think the adrenaline rush of being in that game and the emotions
it's a whole different
and everything.
Level. Oh,
I
yeah.
mean, you're just spent because emotionally and physically and, you know, you're out there on the field. We were going – we had so many guys that went both ways, you know, and so – I didn't really get tired during the season after the first three or four games because I was conditioned so well that it didn't bother me to be in all the time. I didn't want to come out. But I think in a game of that magnitude, it definitely had an impact on us, I think. I think we were a little bit tired coming out.
Right. Well, listen, guys, we got to take a quick time out here. And I appreciate you guys coming in.
You guys
are awesome. And I told Locke here, I said, when we kind of got this whole deal together, we've been working on. I mean, we thought about it like a year and a half ago, but I mean, last night I couldn't hardly sleep. I've already watched the game twice, and it's because I graduated in 1978 from Wrights,
mm-hmm.
and of course I played football there. But I remember that game, and I actually remember watching it.
Yeah.
But it's just great reflecting back 40 years ago. But appreciate you guys.
Yeah. Thank you. Awesome.
I would tell you, Gene, if you want to see a great game, go back and watch the Martinsville game.
Yeah.
That game was probably in our eye, a lot of our eyes, as far as the way it finished.
24-21.
That was the state championship game to us because of the
it was amazing.
It was just phenomenal.
Right.
Back
beautiful.
All right.
Yeah.
Appreciate you guys.
Thanks for having us.
Rodney Russell and Mike Hoag, two members of that 1982 Castle State Football Championship as we celebrate this 40th reunion here at Castle High School. And, man, it's, looking back, it's like I was telling those guys, the film and so forth. And these guys were studs. And anybody that was back in that day that watched that, they know exactly what I am talking about. We're going to take a quick time out. This is the 1982 Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion live from Castle High School right here on the REF ESPN Radio. Hope you're having a great night.
Napa Auto Parts is your local auto parts store that stocks auto parts, tools, and equipment, and many other items for heavy-duty trucks, marine, and farming equipment. Located at 4966 Highway 66 East in Newburgh, they are open Monday through Friday from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturdays from 8 to 3. that are big supporters of Castle Athletics and wish the 1982 state football champions a great 40th anniversary and reunion. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-0433 or visit their website at NapaOnline.com.
People's Bank is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Serving the area for over 125 years, People's is committed to solving problems and creating opportunities for each and every one of our customers. Come see us at one of our four locations in Boonville, Newburg, and our newest branch on North Green River Road in Evansville. Ask about our gold checking account, our Main Street mortgage, or any of our other services. People's Bank. Friendly. Hometown banking. Online at www.peoplestrust.bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender, NMLS 229852. Jimmy John's. They'll make your sandwiches exactly the way you want them because you're the one who's eating it. Tasty sandwiches made fresh when you order. Place an online order for pickup or delivery. Order your favorite Jimmy John's sandwiches to cater your next business or special event. Made fresh to order on their fresh baked bread using hand-sliced meats and fresh veggies. They'll feed as few or as many as you need. Party boxes, box lunches, and mini Jimmy's are totally customizable. And don't forget to grab bags of Jimmy chips, buckets of jumbo kosher pickle spears, and chocolate chip or oatmeal raisin cookies for the whole crew. Jimmy John's. Online ordering and freaky fast delivery. Visit your local Jimmy John's today.
Since 2007, Lawn Masters of Newburg is the go-to company for mole patrol and lawn seeding. Additional services include fee and tick control treatments that will keep fleas, ticks, and chiggers out of your lawn. Need proof? Check out the Castle High School softball field, one of the most beautiful natural grass fields in the tri-state. Call Lawn Masters of Newburg for all your commercial or residential lawn care needs, or visit them online at yourlawnmasters.com. Lawn Masters of Newburg, be happy with your lawn.
Gilkey Chiropractic Clinic is a chiropractic clinic located at 7580 Peachwood Drive in Newburg, Indiana. They specialize in chiropractic care, active release techniques, physical therapy, massage therapy, therapeutic exercise, and nutrition as a drug-free approach to wellness. Gilkey is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics and wishes all teams great success in the brand new year. Gilkey Chiropractic in Newburg. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-2997 or visit their website at GilkeyChiropractic.com.
Are you looking for a local high-end sports bar with great food and a fun bar? Then you are looking for Primetime Pub and Grill in Newburg. You will love their relaxing atmosphere, excellent food, friendly service, and pet-friendly patio. Primetime Pub and Grill offers 24 drafts, 34 bourbons, and a nice selection of wines and other spirits, and now offers brunch on Saturdays and Sundays from 10 until 2. Primetime provides unforgettable food, including great half-pound burgers, fast appetizer choices, steak salads, and, of course, prime rib. Follow them on Instagram and Facebook or browse their online menus at PrimetimeNewburg.com.
The Rooster's Den is your local hometown spot to get all your favorite foods here in Newburg, Indiana. Now open for breakfast and lunch. Located here on Haley Drive, they are open Tuesday through Saturday from 6 a.m. to 2 and Sundays from 7 a.m. to 2. Hey, get all your great stuff, your biscuits and gravy, your waffles, all your great stuff, and you're a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Rooster's Den offers dine-in or carry-out. Hit them up at 812-706-3555 or visit their website at roostersdennewburg.com. Chapman Law, located in downtown Evansville, is a personal injury firm serving Indiana, Kentucky, and Illinois. Chapman offers cases that aren't won by the degrees and diplomas on our walls. Cases are won with hard work, dedication, and attention to detail. Our results speak for themselves. Chapman Law will earn our clients respect by how we treat them on the way to getting those results. Chapman Law in downtown Evansville. For further information, hit them up at 812-426-0600 or visit their website at chapmanlaw.com.
Castle
Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion right here from Castle High School on the Ref. Gene Whirl here, Corey Clayton, our great producer back at the station. Hey, happy Labor Day weekend, folks, 2022. Hope you're having a great weekend and you're going to enjoy some high school football tonight. And a great night here at Castle High School as we celebrate the 40th reunion of the 1982 Castle State Football Champions. And a ton of players here. I mean, we're going to have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 10 players, a couple coaches on the show tonight. And it's just an awesome event, and we appreciate you listening in. Hey, I want to give a shout-out to Pat Locke here. And Pat's helped me kind of doing some of the housework here, getting some players involved and so forth. But he was a senior on the team, and he was the fill-in Eskew Mental Attitude Award winner. So Pat, whom I've known for a long time, through the years, after his high school years, and now he's the long-term coach here on the Castle softball side and a Hall of Famer in that regard himself. So with that, Kenny Brown here, he's on the headset here, and then Craig Day. So, guys, appreciate you stopping in with us. And you know, I saw the notes here, and it says nickname was Downtown Kenny Brown.
Well, that's always dangerous to
see notes. So, I mean, is that just is that something we can talk about on the radio or?
Oh yeah, it's all G rated.
Okay, because this is a family show.
Well, that's good.
If you were a tight end, defensive back, and holder for the kicker, so how'd you get the nickname Downtown?
And it goes back to junior high.
All right.
Basketball coach Mike Rust, he liked giving us all nicknames, and he liked patting it after ex-basketball players out of the NBA. And I was nicknamed after Downtown Freddie Brown.
Oh, Freddie Brown. He actually played for the Pacers.
Yes, he did.
Right? Wow. Well, Craig Day's on the other headset here, and you were a defensive back, and actually you had a great wrestler on top of that. But is that the way you remember it?
It's always Downtown Kenny Brown.
Right?
Yep.
So is that what you're still calling him? Or?
Oh, yeah, you see him every once in a while, you'll drop that line on, just like anybody else who's got a nickname. Us boys will keep that alive forever.
Right. So you guys, I mean, the 40th reunion here, that 1982 Castle State Football Championship, and, a lot of players that played integral parts of that championship season. But, you guys have magical seasons, so, I just thought, both your comments, Kenny. I mean, was this something that you kind of felt building through the years, or as you came into that senior year?
Well, it all started in the junior high. When we were in junior high school, we all sat in the weight room and we were saying, "Hey, it all starts here. We can be, we can win a state championship, but we got to put our minds to it." And we never lost that all the way through high school. We built on it, and the best part about it is everybody bought in. It wasn't just a few of us. It was everybody on the team believed that we could do it.
Right.
I was a late arrival. I come up here eighth grade year from Kentucky, and so the boys had another year on me. But from that point on, it was always, we're going to do this. There was really no doubt. It just got stronger as the years progressed. The time we got to be a senior, it's like, we're going to win this.
Well, and Craig, Kenny, he was kind of a newbie coming in, and especially from Kentucky, right?
Well, we might as well be in Kentucky. I mean, we're just across the river, so.
Right. Any memories of, when Craig came in, probably right off the bat, you knew he was a pretty good athlete. So how'd that transition go with fitting in with the guys?
Well, coming over from Kentucky, the first thing I know Boo had to tell himself and tell his parents that he had to have socks to play football.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
is that right, Craig? Or?
That is right. I showed up here and, we were from the country and come up here and it's like, man, everybody's wearing socks. I got to tell Mom and Dad I got to get some socks.
Right.
I'm not looking in the style here.
Well, apparently you fit in pretty good. And, you know, that year, I mean, you've four shutouts and all the great games. I mean, you know, you got by Martinsville there, 24-21.
Yeah.
Then you beat the nemesis, Carmel. And it seems like, man, down here, down south, that Carmel was always like
We wanted them bad.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. So, you won that tight one there with Martinsville, and, you know, you ran that hook and ladder play. That was a big play of that game there. But just, you know, kind of talk about, you know, as you got into the tournaments, some of those games there that propelled you to the state championship game against Hobart.
Well, you know, you talk about the Carmel game. That's a good example because, you know, once we got through halftime, we saw them ducking their heads. And once we were in the third quarter, they were done. And we knew we had it, so we just, you know, we were one of those teams where you just didn't put the brakes on. You know, we're gonna run over you, run through you, but we were going to get there. And that was a big part of our motto in every game we play.
Right. So after that Carmel game, you're going to take on Hobart. They were undefeated too, coming in at 13-0, and had a legendary coach, I think Don Jewell. And I mean, these are the Northerners, if you will.
That's about as northern as you can get.
Yeah, exactly. That's kind of the point I was getting at. And like I was talking to the guys right before you, Rodney and Mike, that was a rainy night there at Indianapolis North Central, about 50 degrees, and it was just kind of a miserable night. But Craig, on that game there, what do you remember about, you know, man, we're in the state championship game, and pregame, you're going out there, you know you're there, and you got one left to make this a complete season. What do you remember about how that approach there?
Well, I could say I was honestly never concerned that we wouldn't make it. We had two big plays in the game book. One was a fleet flicker, one was reverse 47 pass that everybody was aware of. I remember Coach saying that what they don't know is we're going to use those plays in the first few plays of the game. And they worked, and they set us right up. You know, within three plays, we're ready to be on the goal line. And I think we just played strong the whole game. When it got really close and serious, I remember them pulling the seniors in, and we actually held off and pulled that game out. So.
Well, and Kenny, you remember, I mean, you played defensive back too, right, Craig?
Yes.
Was that your main position?
Defensive end was my main position.
Yeah, and then you also played
Well, we switched out.
You
tied in.
You played offense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, tied in.
But in that game, I was watching that tape, and Kenny had a great game himself. But you had a really pretty big pass. You caught a big pass in that fourth quarter.
I did, because I wasn't the receiving tight end. I was the blocking tight end. And I remember running that play, and there's a little hook, and turning around and watching that ball go all the way past my hands and said, don't drop it.
Right.
And it was a big play because I think it was a fourth down play. We got the first down.
It was, and you know that because at that time, guys, you were, Hobart, they had a 23-20 lead on you.
Yeah, they were up three.
So you know it's kind of coming to a point where it's make or break, and then you know you guys ended up scoring, but then you had to hold them.
Yep,
right.
So, I remember that well.
Can you remember Kenny's stuff about that last maybe that last drive there? Because I think it was Hobart had the ball. My notes say like about a minute or so left.
Yeah, they didn't have the time to run down the field, so they were going to have to air it out. And backfield did a great job. I know Gillis, he contributed.
I think Huff had a big sack too.
Oh yes, big time. Yeah, I can remember, you know, laying out trying to knock passes down just to keep it out of their hands, you know. So it was the make or break for that entire game.
Well, then you basically, you know, you ran the clock out.
Yep.
And uh, the uh, you got that that victory there on November 20th. What did you guys did you go up there on the game day, or did you go up the night before?
Night before, we did a little pregame.
You remember where you stayed?
It was in Terre Haute, didn't we?
I think so.
Yeah, because we practiced. We did a pregame practice the day before on Terre Haute's football field, and that kind of got us going. Get our heads, you know, get your heads right. You know, you're out of school. Now it's just concentrate nothing but football, and that's what we did. And I think it paid off getting away the day before just to get that mindset.
Right.
And, you know, of course, we'd always set in and listen to that tape, right?
Right.
The great motivational tape of all time that Johnny Evers loved to play.
Right. Well, we're going to talk to him about that, too.
Oh, yeah.
But that game there, so you won the game 26-23. So what happened after that? Did you guys come back?
I think we spent the night.
We spent the night up there. Yeah. Okay, we came back the next day.
So you came back, all came back on the bus?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We came down.
Yeah, we had a couple
come down 41 on the buses.
So what was that bus ride like on the way back, knowing that you were the 3A state champs?
I don't know. The whole time was pretty high event. Just coming back, you know, after the game, all the way home, all the way going through the fire stations there, or getting on the fire trucks there in Newburgh. It was just, I mean, you were proud. It was very big excitement with the families and friends around. I mean, it was a big to-do back in the day, even for Evansville.
Right.
I mean, we were.
Oh, absolutely.
We were not just Newburgh fans. You saw Evansville.
Oh, east side, west Evansville side. Was all behind it.
Well, we all came together.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there'd never been a true state champion that got played out. You know, Wright's had a great team back in the 70s, you know, mythical state champions, and we were proud of that. I mean, we built on that. We talked about that. You know, let's go do what Wright's did.
Yeah.
And that's what we did. That's what we set out to do.
When's the last time you watched it?
Probably been 25 years ago.
Correct. Mine was probably 5 years ago.
5 years ago.
Yeah, it's cleaning up, come across the tape. Slid it in. It's like, yeah, that's fun to watch.
Do you ever get tired of watching it?
No. It's hard to remember some of it anymore, but
right.
It's fun to rewatch. I almost pulled it out before we had the interview here, but I was like, it's going to be what's going to be.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a good time. It was a fun year.
We're talking about Craig Day and Kenny Brown. So, Craig Day, what are you doing these days?
Well, I work at electronics research. I've become an electrical engineer. I've been doing that for 35 years now.
All right.
And so I work with Kenny there at Electronics Research there in Chandler.
Okay, so you both work for the same company.
Yeah, we got all married back up, you know, as
right.
our friends. And,
right, so,
and
you're, so it's you, been, you're still a team 40 years ago. I mean, 40 years.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, yeah, we, you know, hang out at work and go down
right.
to the lakes and hang out. And,
right.
So, you know, Boo's a great guy. You know, we built a big friendship years ago, you know, when he first came in. And it was good to hook up with him again after about, 30 years?
Yeah. Well, and I was talking with Lockyer prior to, you know, the program here. And I know it's the 40th reunion, but this is stuff and I think until you experience it, you know, winning something like a state championship, it's a lifetime gem. It sticks with you the whole time.
Oh yeah, doesn't go away.
Yeah, and you guys, even in, you know, 20 years or whatever, you're still going to remember it.
Well, you know, funny story. When I actually went in to apply for a job in electronics research, I was talking to the president of the company, and one of his questions was, weren't you on that state football team? I go, yes, sir, I was.
There you go.
Can you start on Monday?
That's
I go, yes,
right.
Absolutely.
So that was a good resume builder.
That was
party
a good
too.
Resume builder.
So
yes.
Is that what you did too, Craig? Or?
No.
You didn't have to, right?
He brought that engineering degree with him.
Right. Yeah. Right. Well, listen, guys, I appreciate you, and thanks for stopping by.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
It'd be good to hook up with the guys again. And,
yeah.
Yeah, shoot the stuff.
Right. Well, we'll have a great weekend.
All right. Thank you.
All right. That's Craig Boudet and Kenny Brown there, and two big parts of this 1982 Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion. We're going to take a quick timeout here and come back with some more great stuff. And we're going to have a couple coaches. Coach Johnny Evers, he was the offensive line coach and later became the AD here at Castle, an unbelievable career at that, and also Marc Anderson. So we'll take about a two-minute timeout. This is the Castle High School State Football Championship 40th reunion right here on the REF, ESPN Radio. Glad to have you. Chapman Law, located in downtown Evansville, is a personal injury firm serving Indiana, Kentucky, and Illinois. Chapman offers cases that aren't won by the degrees and diplomas on our walls. Cases are won with hard work, dedication, and attention to detail. Our results speak for themselves. Chapman Law will earn our clients respect by how we treat them on the way to getting those results. Chapman Law in downtown Evansville. For further information, hit them up at 812-426-0600 or visit their website at chapmanlaw.com. Gilkey Chiropractic Clinic is a chiropractic clinic located at 7580 Peachwood Drive in Newburgh, Indiana. They specialize in chiropractic care, active release techniques, physical therapy, massage therapy, therapeutic exercise, and nutrition as a drug-free approach to wellness. Gilkey is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics and wishes all teams great success in the brand new year. Gilkey Chiropractic in Newburgh. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-2997 or visit their website at gilkeychiropractic.com.
Jimmy John's. They'll make your sandwiches exactly the way you want them because you're the one who's eating it. Tasty sandwiches made fresh when you order. Place an online order for pickup or delivery. Order your favorite Jimmy John's sandwiches to cater your next business or special event. Made fresh to order on their fresh baked bread using hand-sliced meats and fresh veggies. They'll feed as few or as many as you need. Party boxes, box lunches, and mini Jimmy's are totally customizable. And don't forget to grab bags of Jimmy chips, buckets of jumbo kosher pickle spears, and chocolate chip or oatmeal raisin cookies for the whole crew. Jimmy John's, online ordering and freaky fast delivery. Visit your local Jimmy John's today.
Since 2007, Lawn Masters of Newburgh is the go-to company for mole patrol and lawn seeding. Additional services include fee and tick control treatments that will keep fleas, ticks, and chiggers out of your lawn. Need proof? Check out the Castle High School softball field, one of the most beautiful natural grass fields in the tri-state. Call Lawn Masters of Newburgh for all your commercial or residential lawn care needs, or visit them online at yourlawnmasters.com. Lawn Masters of Newburgh, be happy with your lawn.
People's Bank is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Serving the area for over 125 years, Peoples is committed to solving problems and creating opportunities for each and every one of our customers. Come see us at one of our four locations in Boonville, Newburgh, and our newest branch on North Green River Road in Evansville. Ask about our gold checking account, our Main Street mortgage, or any of our other services. Peoples Bank, friendly, hometown banking. Online at www.peoplestrust.bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender, NMLS 229852.
Are you looking for a local high-end sports bar with great food and a fun bar? Then you're looking for Primetime Pub and Grill in Newburgh. You will love their relaxing atmosphere, excellent food, friendly service, and pet-friendly patio. Primetime Pub and Grill offers 24 drafts, 34 bourbons, and a nice selection of wines and other spirits, and now offers brunch on Saturdays and Sundays from 10 until 2. Primetime provides unforgettable food, including great half-pound burgers, fast appetizer choices, steak salads, and, of course, prime rib. Follow them on Instagram and Facebook or browse their online menus at primetimenewburgh.com.
ESPN 97.7 WREF, Seabree, Henderson, and Evansville. ESPN 97.7 The Ref.
Of the 1982 Castle State Football Championship right here on the REF. Glad to have you tonight, folks. Hope you're having a great evening here on this Football Friday. And we're going to have Wrights and Jasper immediately following this program at 6 o'clock. We'll shoot it over to Ryan Metzger and Josh Woody there at the bowl. And this Wrightson. Corey Brunson takes on the Jasper Wildcats and Tony Lewis, former Wrights coach. Hey, how about our sponsors real quick again? Castle Athletics, Chapman Injury Lawyers, Gilkey, Cairo and Sports, Jimmy John's, Lawn Masters of Newburgh, Newburgh Auto Parts, People's Bank, Primetime Pub and Grill, and the Rooster's Den. And a great evening here. We've had a bunch of players on. Now we're going to go to the coaches. We got John Evers and Marc Anderson. So, guys, glad to have you tonight. And you told me off the air here, John, that hey, both of you guys live in Indianapolis.
Yeah, we're in that area.
That's crazy.
Yep.
So you just can't get rid of him or what?
Yeah, hang together.
Well, John Evers and Marc Anderson here. And did you guys know that gas in 1982 was $1.22?
I wish it was again.
Oh, yeah. Right. That would make the trip down here a little bit
easier.
But John Evers, one of the coaches, and later one of the greatest ADs in my mind, John, ever in this area in the SIC. So appreciate all your
National Hall of Famer.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, his resume, it would be pretty dang long. But you guys were the coaches on the team with Coach Leidy, and just both of you just kind of chime in and talk about that season.
Well, it starts really in 1978. We came in the same year. I came in as assistant freshman coach, and the head freshman coach was Mike Gable. And at the end of the first week, Mike told John, "I'm going back to Mater Dei."
Right.
And Tony Andrello got on the horn and got Mark hired, and the two of us were freshman coaches the year before these seniors got into high school. And then I moved up to the varsity, and Mark stayed at the freshman level for I don't know how many years and just kept beating the dog out of people and getting those kids ready to go. And so we came in together.
Well, Mark, that's got to be fond memories for you. I know it's been 40 years since that run you had there in 82, but and all the guys I've talked to tonight, the memories are still pretty vivid.
Absolutely. Kind of like Johnny was talking there, Coach Evers. I don't really know if I've ever called him Johnny hardly. I've always called him Coach Evers all my life because of the respect I have for him. We had that group of kids in 78 that went on to get to the Final Four in 81. And I think Coach Leidy made one of the greatest coaching moves of all time. When those kids were sophomores, he could have moved them up to the varsity, and he kept all of them except maybe one, Biggs, on the reserve team, and they went undefeated that year on the reserve team. They kept that winning attitude while the varsity was still getting creamed and ended up with a 1-9 season. But that was a gutsy move because we could have probably gone 5-5 if those kids had moved up. We'd had a decent season. But he kept those kids back and kept them winning and everything like that on the JV level. And Coach Everson, one of the coaches of that JV team, I thought that was a tremendous move, don't you?
I do. Yeah, that was huge. Because Mark and I talked earlier, there's not many high schools where you can lose 19 straight games.
Right. And still have a job.
And then 3 years later, we're in the Final Four. And 4 years later, we win a state championship. I mean, you look around, that doesn't happen. So, yeah, there was good coaching, but there was an administration that took a lot of heat and said, these guys know what they're doing. John Leidy knows what he's doing. And they hung in there, and they were right. I've been around a lot of coaches, but not anybody as steady and as even keeled as he was.
Absolutely. We had petitions in the stands to get us fired at that time in 79.
They passed one to my wife and Nancy Leidy, and that didn't go well.
Right. We talked with Johnny Evers and the coaches, Johnny and Marc Anderson here. What do you remember about Coach Leidy and, of course, you know, the heart attack and so forth and, the smash mouth, the football and so forth. But, on the side where you're at the hip with him as a coach, what do you guys remember about him on that side of it?
Unflappable. He never got too high or got too low, and I think that the team was reflected in that. You see a lot of coaches just go crazy, and the teams follow. And he was, if he was up 50 or down 50, he was the same guy. And when you got away from football, he was the same guy. And I think the kids really responded to that. Many of these guys on these teams didn't have a good home life. He was the father figure, and he was to us as coaches and really those players. I mean, they would run through a brick wall for the man, and I think that's the ultimate compliment.
same thing kind of like he was saying there, Coach Leidy would deflect all the praise and everything to us. Like Johnny and I were winning big on the freshman level, and then Johnny moves up, and they keep winning on the JV level, and they keep winning and winning and winning. And like he said, we kept winning on the freshman level. We won 35 games in a row, and people would keep saying, you know, giving us glory and everything, and Coach Leidy would just keep the praise coming to us and everything. He wouldn't take any himself, but Coach Leidy was the glue behind Castle football, and I learned so much from him. He's a class individual. You can't find a more class individual than Coach Leidy was, and he was a defensive genius. I would walk up to him on Friday, and if he said he had the plan and he thought he could stop the other team, I knew we were going to win. I absolutely knew we'd win if he thought he had their number.
One of his best, I remember, we played Richmond in 82, and they had a great ball club. We barely beat them the year before, and he saw something on film. He said, I'm going to walk this linebacker up, and looking at their how they block it, and they're going to see Rodney stepping up. Guard's going to take him, and I'm going to bring Joe Huff off the edge. He had either four or five sacks.
Yeah, he killed him.
Crucial. Just blew him up. And that was all one guy looking at film saying, this is what we're going to do. And the kids kind of looked around and went, wow. You know, they didn't look around. They knew. When he said this is going to work, it worked.
When you guys, you had the practices and so forth, then you got the game plan. But as a coach, the practice preparation and then, you know, going to practice, what was like that under the Leidy regime?
Here's something that people will not, they think I'm lying. In my 10 years on the varsity, we never had a Saturday or Sunday coaches meeting. Now, when I was a head coach, we met every weekend. We talked about, we didn't have to. He said, Jerry Sims, you know what you got to do. John Evers, you know what you got to do. Bob Rogers, you know what you got to do. Just do it. And so we knew each other so well that it, and he was not afraid to give people responsibility and say, go, take off, run with it.
Right.
And when you screwed up, it was his fault, not yours.
And one of the amazing things was something he just said right there. If you look at some of the programs across the state, even at that time, they had 15, 20 coaches. We had four on the varsity. We had me on the freshman, and I had an assistant that volunteered to help me. And that's all the coaches we had. I mean, he was the line coach. Sims was the backfield coach. Rogers was the defensive line coach.
Coach Rink.
And there was Leidy. And then Coach Rink was my assistant that year.
Yeah. We're talking with Marc Anderson here and John Evers, the coaches from the Castle High School, the great teams, let's just say back in the day. And they're both from living in Indianapolis now. But do you remember the pregame speech at when you got to North Central that night as you were getting ready to take on Hobart?
I don't know if he ever gave a pregame speech.
That wasn't
ever
him. You know, he would just say,
no emotion.
Go. You know, let's go. And the kids took care of it. You know, it was just he was not going. His whole concept was, if I get you sky high, you're not going to play well. I want you ready to play, and let's go.
He and I were the crazy people. And
you have to have that on staff. You know, you've got to have those people, whatever. To tell you how calm he was, I've never told this story. We were in the hotel ready to get on the bus, and we were playing cards in our room to get ready for the state championship.
Wow.
The four varsity coaches. You go, no, that's what we did, because he said, hay's in the barn. It's all there. We just got to show up and play. Let's play cards. And we said, okay. And that was him. He said, you know, don't get too high, don't get too low, and just let her rip. And when we started practice back then, he would wait. Kids would want to hit the first day in pads. He said, no, I can't do that. He'd wait two or three days, and I want you wanting to hit. And I'm not going to beat you. And that's one of the great things he did back then, is he didn't beat kids up in practice. And that a lot of places, you got programs that were losing kids in practice. I don't think I ever remember a kid getting hurt in our practices, because he wasn't going to let it happen.
Right.
So I'm going to lose enough of you on Friday night. I'm not going to beat you up on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Do you, Mark, do you remember you guys watching a lot of film?
We watched a lot of film. That's like he was talking about how Coach Leidy came up with the thing at Richmond, sending Joe off the edge there. But it was more instinct. We had more instinct than anything else. I think we had a feel for people we were going to play and stuff like that.
The worst film session we ever had was when we watched Hobart. because we didn't know anything about Hobart. We were in his John Lighty's basement in Washington, and we watched about 5 minutes, and somebody said, what in the hell have we gotten ourselves into?
Yeah.
Because that was the biggest, strongest.
They had that lefty quarterback Mills was pretty good.
But their defense, they had a
and
big.
That running back they had.
And he was a backup. Their number one running back got hurt at the start of the year. They had a middle linebacker named Fonseca. And he was
6'5", 2".
Oh, he was just unbelievable. We saw him. We said, now, Neil Chapman, you've got to go out and block this guy.
Right.
And then we kind of went, I don't know.
They had two linebackers, Fonseca and Lipke. And this is no exaggeration. They did not go through warm-up the night of the pregame. In the pregame, they stood at the 50-yard line, and they stood and badmouthed our kids the entire time.
Wow.
And, you know, Fonseca was a man among boys. I mean, we didn't have any. But we had one starter on both sides of the ball for the whole season was actually over 200 pounds. We didn't have any other starters. Steve Yeager was the only one who was actually over 200.
I'm looking at the roster right here.
Steve was 225, and that was it. Yeah.
That was our only guy. You can't win in big-time football and only have one player that's over 200 pounds.
Because this was the biggest class.
Yeah, this was the biggest of the big.
And that was the 10th state championship. Once they started going to the tournament, so now what is it? It's six classes now.
Yeah.
But this was the big of the big, and I was talking to Kenny Brown and Boo Day here. It seemed like down south here we were always the stepchild.
Yep.
And Carmel was always at the top of the list. And then, you guys knocked them off 21-8.
And that was sweet because of the way that Coach Lighty was a really good friend with Jim Belden. And they were talking pregame, and John came back, and, I mean, he was turning blue. And I went, what's wrong? He said, you won't believe what that guy just said. I said, what'd he say? He said, you got a nice little team there.
Yeah.
John. And, I mean, he was just lit.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah.
And we told the kids that, and they went, oh. And there was no respect, and that was you have to earn respect. And that night, because the year before they had just kicked their tail, and they thought they were going to do it again. And so when it was 7-0 us at halftime, they still said, "I will come back." And then we went up 21-0. And you just look, their fans left, their coaches kind of ducked, and they couldn't believe it.
Yeah. Well, one last question. So after that the game there, you know you're going to go play the state game there at North Central, but. What were the coaches like after that? We're going to the big dance now, but can you guys reflect on what you guys were feeling?
Funny enough, we took out half our offense. We looked at them and said, we can't run all this power stuff. They'll beat us up. And we put as much junk in as we could. We ran reverse passes and flea flickers and anything known to man. And they worked because we knew if we just tried to play smash mouth, they would have shoved it. And so we shocked them by just doing stuff. And funny enough, my son was a coach in Illinois, and one of his assistants for a couple of years played on that Hobart team. He was a sophomore. And he always talks about, we don't know how you guys beat us. And I said, we don't either. And you don't have to be the best every night. You got to be the best one night. And that night,
right.
We were the best.
It was 26-23, but I never felt it was a close game. I thought we controlled that game. One thing I want to mention, though, was when we got back to Evansville the next day, and we got to the airport. The four varsity coaches got a limousine. We pulled in at the airport, and they got in a limousine. I stayed on the bus with the players. And I'm getting goosebumps. From the time we left the airport in Evansville, there were people on both sides of the road the entire way to Castle Gym. Now, these are people from Memorial, Bosse, Harrison.
Yeah. Right.
They're everywhere supporting us. Get back to the gym, and it's packed. I mean, how can you go all the way from the airport to Castle's Gym and it be solid people all along the road? I mean, that's a tribute to people don't understand how big football is down here and how tight the schools are, even though they want to kill each other each weekend, like Wrights and us and North and all those people. But those people came out and were alongside the road to support us.
We're one then.
We're one.
And it showed people that the South can do it. Until that point, Wrights had gotten there in 77.
Yeah.
That was the last big school to get there. Got beat by Portage. And there was just that feeling that the Southern schools can't do it.
Yeah.
And that when that happened, all those other schools said, it can happen. And it has since then. You've seen several of them up there.
Right. Well, listen, guys, we got to take a quick time out here. But appreciate you guys.
Sure thing.
And John Edwards and Marc Anderson, two great coaches. And John, of course, AD here at Castle for a long, long time. But It's great reflecting on 40 years ago.
Always fun.
Yeah, appreciate you. Right, we're going to take a quick time out here. This is the 1982 Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion right here from Castle High School on the Ref. Glad to have you.
Chapman Law, located in downtown Evansville, is a personal injury firm serving Indiana, Kentucky, and Illinois. Chapman offers cases that aren't won by the degrees and diplomas on our walls. Cases are won with hard work, dedication, and attention to detail. Our results speak for themselves. Chapman Law will earn our clients respect by how we treat them on the way to getting those results. Chapman Law in downtown Evansville. For further information, hit them up at 812-426-0600 or visit their website at chapmanlaw.com.
Since 2007, Lawn Masters of Newburgh is the go-to company for mole patrol and lawn seeding. Additional services include fee and tick control treatments that will keep fleas, ticks, and chiggers out of your lawn. Need proof? Check out the Castle High School softball field, one of the most beautiful natural grass fields in the tri-state. Call Lawn Masters of Newburgh for all your commercial or residential lawn care needs, or visit them online at yourlawnmasters.com. Lawn Masters of Newburgh. Be happy with your lawn.
Napa Auto Parts is your local auto parts store that stocks auto parts, tools, and equipment, and many other items for heavy-duty trucks, marine, and farming equipment. Located at 4966 Highway 66 East in Newburgh, they are open Monday through Friday from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturdays from 8 to 3. They are big supporters of Castle Athletics and wish the 1982 state football champions a great 40th anniversary and reunion. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-0433. Or visit their website at NapaOnline.com.
Are you looking for a local high-end sports bar with great food and a fun bar? Then you're looking for Primetime Pub & Grill in Newburgh. You will love their relaxing atmosphere, excellent food, friendly service, and pet-friendly patio. Primetime Pub & Grill offers 24 drafts, 34 bourbons, and a nice selection of wines and other spirits, and now offers brunch on Saturdays and Sundays from 10 until 2. Primetime provides unforgettable food, including great half-pound burgers, fast appetizer choices, steak salads, and, of course, prime rib. Follow them on Instagram and Facebook or browse their online menus at primetimenewburgh.com.
The Rooster's Den is your local hometown spot to get all your favorite foods here in Newburgh, Indiana, now open for breakfast and lunch. Located here on Haley Drive, they are open Tuesday through Saturday from 6 a.m. to 2 and Sundays from 7 a.m. to 2. Hey, get all your great stuff, your biscuits and gravy, your waffles, all your great stuff, and they're a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Rooster's Den offers dine-in or carry-out. Hit them up at 812-706-3555 or visit their website at roostersdennewburgh.com.
Back here at Castle High School, the 40th reunion of the 1982 Castle State Football Championship team, the 3A champs, and what a great night here, folks. Hope you're having a great evening out there on this start to Labor Day weekend. We've had 2, 4, 6. We're going to have 10 players here. We've got the Brosmers here, Dave and David and Chris. Had a couple coaches. We're trying to hit a little bit of everybody here. But just a great night here at Castle High School as these guys reflect on 40 years of winning that 3A state title. So Chris and David's here. So appreciate you guys. And, well, Chris, I mean, you're the younger of the tandem here. You were a junior at that time, and David was a senior.
Yeah. Yeah, it was, me and Dave grew up together, so it was like, you know, it was almost like we were the same age.
Yeah.
You know, we're close. You know, we're 10.5 months apart. So,
wow.
So it's almost like we're twins. But you know, we've been, so it hasn't been like he was the older brother most of the time. We were always doing things together. So we just grew up that way, and it stayed that way once we got into high school. And It worked out real great on the football field.
Right. Well, and David, I mean, you know, you were, of course, a senior at that time, running back, and all-purpose player. And you played at U of E. Did you both play at U of E?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Who did you play for at U of E? Was that
Randy
Rogers? Randy,
yeah.
Did you play for R2?
I played for Randy, too. Yeah, we just had a reunion just a couple weeks ago for him. So.
Right. So David, I mean, you know, you were the, let's just say, the elder of the Brosmers. And talk about the competition you had with your brother. It's a family show now.
Yeah, I know. I understand. I mean, most people understand when, if they know anything about us, that we could fight over a game of checkers.
Right.
You know, so, I mean, we grew up very competitive. I used to tell people, I think what prepared us a lot for playing football is we would play in the yard and throw the ball to the other end of the yard as high as we could so you could run down and hit them before they had a chance.
Right.
To do anything. Right. You know, and then you had to make a move or you were going to get creamed.
Yeah.
And there was one time, threw it up, he catches it, ducks his head, I duck mine, and we're both laid flat out on the lawn.
Wow.
So, I mean, that's just, it was made us tough. It made us, you know, have to avoid each other, avoid tackles, and make tackles. So,
right.
I mean,
well, you know, and we're talking with David Brosmer and Chris Brosmer here. You know, even though like you said, 10.5 months older, it didn't really seem like there's an age difference. Is that right, Chris?
Yeah, no. I mean, like I said, we grew up playing on every team together. So, you know, it never seemed like I was that kid that came in after Dave. It was like I came in with Dave, and we were always doing stuff together. And like I said, we would play tiddlywinks to, you know, and we would give 110% playing tiddlywinks. So we were that competitive with each other, and it was like, you know, it never changed. We did that from, you know, the time we can remember playing baseball, my dad coach, you know, till we played together even in college, you know. Of course, you know, we didn't play in the backfield together in college, but
right.
But
I think that's what made our team special, too, is because basically that camaraderie was our two classes were close.
Yeah.
All of us. And we knew what was at stake, and we all knew what we wanted out of, you know, playing football at Castle.
Well, and, you know, and that's a great point there. Talking to David Brosmer and Chris Brosmer here. You look at that team, and I kind of went down the roster. And so you guys... There were 15 seniors, 19 juniors, and 14 sophomores.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it was a great mix, you know, from the sophomore class on up. And, you know, in looking at this whole roster here, that was it wasn't like it was senior dominated, you know, because you see a lot of schools that they're dominated by seniors. But you guys, you know, your seniors, David, I mean, you guys, just like you were saying, you counted on the juniors and some of the other guys, too, to make this team successful.
Well, we had to have them to fill in the roles that we, you know, lacked as far as positions for seniors and the people that were starting. I mean,
well, you have your best players on the field, you know, and then, but we can't do it. Even though we're young and 17, 18 years old, you got to have a rest. And, you know, those sophomores and us juniors that came in to fill those spots, we didn't lose much at all. I mean, and he talks about, you know, how close we were in classes, kind of to elaborate on that. We have reunions like everybody else does every 5 years. Well, we have reunions, and all three of those classes come to the same. We go to their reunions, they go to ours, we go to the class below us. We're all so close. We just come to everybody's class reunion.
That's pretty cool. That's really unique.
Yeah,
you don't see that. So yeah, you guys had this this season. You went 14-0 and so forth. But and I haven't talked about this yet. But what was it like, you know, roaming the hallways here? I mean, we're in the cafeteria of Castle right now. But just, you know, being part of something special, and you know. Everybody's obviously looking up to you and so forth, but what was it like being a student, you know, you as a junior, you as a senior, roaming these high schools at Castle High School?
I can tell you from my side of it, we had a lot of teachers that really supported
football. And as a matter of fact, I can remember my advanced comp class teacher would have me every Friday come up to the class board or the chalkboard and draw out the play that we were going to start the game with.
Wow.
Every game.
Right.
Including when we left for the state championship. So. Wow. And we knew what we were doing, right? You know, the coaches always had us prepared. We knew at all times, whether you're practicing, playing, or whatever. We knew what was going to happen and how it was going to happen, and all we had to do was go out and execute.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Every teacher supported us. You know, a lot of people don't know this, but I got hurt on Bloomington South game, tore the ligament in my ankle. So I missed most of the year. And teacher, finally they got me on an ice bucket routine where I'd a 5-gallon bucket, stick my ankle in there. Because I couldn't have surgery. I was gone the whole year.
Right.
So the teacher would let me out of class because I'd have to do it 20 minutes every 2 hours. And they'd let me out of class for a partial time to go do that every couple hours. And so they were supportive of that too. You know, they made sure that I got my work done. But at the same time, everybody in the school thought about that. It was all, everything surrounded football.
Sure. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. The hallways, it just, you felt like kind of like a rock star.
Yeah.
Right. You know, you did, because everybody would say, you know, you pass somebody in the hall and they're giving you five, or they're saying something about, you know, what's coming up this week, you know, and go get them. And, you know, when I look back at us playing, you know, the Martinsville game, you look at it and we were down in that game, we never were afraid that we were going to lose.
So that was kind of mantra that, we're still going to find a way, because it was the hook and ladder in that game there that kind of was that pushed you over the edge, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, a lot of plays leading up to that, obviously, but I can remember right before that series, they had a chance to run the clock out, and then, you know, I think they were a little mad the year before. We gave them a pretty good thumping down here, and he got greedy and wanted to score again. They threw three straight in completions. And I was involved in the last play, diving out of bounds with one of their players. And a guy on their sideline picked me up. He said, "Great game, buddy. It was over." And I turned around and I said, "It ain't over yet." Ran back to the sideline.
What was it like in that huddle on that play that kind of sealed the deal for you there, Martinsville?
On the play?
That? Yeah.
Well, basically, you know, I know the coaches were thinking about it and everything, but, you know, after you've run that play a couple times, it's a high-profile play, and I'm out of position when I'm sitting in the slot. So I went to the sideline. Chris had come in for me, and I had injured my hand a little bit, I think, in that game. And I said something to Coach Sims. I said, "Hey, why don't we try hook and ladder?" I said, "That guy can't stay with me. I can beat him." You know, and a couple of plays later, he said, "All right, go in, you know, take it in." And of course, the rest was history. I mean, I remember that play. I was kind of shielded by our sideline, and Deon had flipped me the ball. Well, they thought he fumbled. Our whole stance thought he fumbled. I kind of heard the, "Oh." But when I cleared the end of our players,
right,
my finger up.
Right.
They knew then.
You know, that was another play to us. It wasn't like it was a trick play, because we ran that so many times. There was only one time out of the year. What did we score? Four or five times with it?
Three.
Three out of four. And you also did it in a Hobart game.
Yes.
Deon to you, right?
Yeah. Yeah, well, he screwed that up, because that was – the coach came over, just to tell everybody a little funny thing about that, because when he got to the sideline after he scored, Coach Sims looked at me and he said, "Why didn't you run the flea flicker?" I said, "Well, Dave told me to go to tailback." They looked at Dave because they knew Dave would never ran slot hardly at all.
Right, yeah.
It was either me or Neil in the slot. So,
yeah.
So when they put Dave in the slot, they would read that hey, that's when they would run the flea flicker. Well, he looked at Dave and he goes, "Well, good thing you scored."
Right.
And I'm like, "That's right. You took a touchdown away from
him." Right.
So I never did get to run the hook and ladder because of that.
What, all right. Chris, when's the last time you watched the tape of the game?
Of that game, probably the Martinsville game?
Of the state game.
Of the state game.
Hoburn.
I watched the Martinsville game last night.
Did you?
I watched the state game. It's probably been a couple years.
Same.
I watch it.
Probably a year or two.
When this stuff come on, actually, if I probably would have had enough time, I wanted to watch the Martinsville game, because that was probably the toughest game we went through and the most exciting.
Yeah.
You know, the state championship game, of course, is, you know, when you end it and your dreams come true. But I, you know, that Martinsville game was just, they came out on the sidelines and they were saying some things that they shouldn't have been saying.
Yeah.
And so it was that was the game that I like to go back and watch. And just because, you know, see your brother going down the sideline, that's pretty cool.
Well, and their coach, I still think it was Bill Seiderwitz.
Yes.
And he, let's just say, he was a fairly arrogant guy himself.
Yes.
Because when he came down to the bowl in 77, I think it was 77, he called us the Ritz Crackers. but he was pretty arrogant.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
and it kind of, you know, it kind of trickled down to his players, like you guys were saying. But so you guys are still pretty close.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, we play a lot of golf together, and we hunt and fish together. So we'll probably spend a lot more time together than we did. You know, it's just, I'd say, I can't say when we were younger because we live in the same household.
Yeah.
But we get together quite a bit. So
we're talking with Chris and David Brosmer as far as kids.
I got three girls. So
David, what do you got?
I have two girls. Casey's 30, lives out in Arizona. Amanda is here. She's 28. And then I have a son at Colorado University.
So five 22. Girls between you.
Yeah.
Five girls and one boy.
Right.
To tell you how that
right.
works, everybody talks about boys wanting to have, you know, you want to have, we're sports nuts, so we want to
sure.
have boys to carry on that stuff. So, you know, my mom used to drive a school bus. Funny story real quick that this lady used to try to get her to go to a palm reader real quick, you know, and she's like, no, I'm not going to do that. So she was bored one time, and she said, went to this palm reader. She said the lady either was way off base or she knew stuff she shouldn't know. It was freaky. She said, told us that one of your boys will have three girls.
Wow.
Well, when she went there, Dave had already had two girls.
Right.
Well, my girls are 24, 25, and 26.
Right.
So, boom, boom, boom.
There
and
you go.
Dave had his third one after mine, and it was a boy. And I said, because I told him when she said that, I said, well, you're going to have the cheerleaders, and I'm going to have the football players.
Right.
And guess what? I had the cheerleaders.
Yeah, you had the cheerleaders. It's funny how that all works out.
Yeah.
So, all right. So, we got Chris Brosmer and David Brosmer here. Who's the best golfer?
I'm closing the gap, but he's...
Yeah. So Chris
yeah.
is
yeah.
The younger.
He's
the younger one.
Yeah. I'm about a 6 handicap going down to a 5, and he's about a 12. So
12. Okay.
Yeah,
so because.
But I don't give him strokes when we play. He might get
well,
him
no.
in our league.
No, you're not doing that. Are you crazy? Come on
no,
now.
No. And head to head,
come
he
on.
Doesn't get
strokes. How about a couple?
No.
He won't.
No,
be
I don't give him any.
Right.
I gotta beat him. And I've maybe beat him 3 times in my own.
Okay, so David, what are you better than Chris at?
Cornhole.
Cornhole. Is that correct?
Well, same thing. I'm getting close. He used to
okay.
beat me all the time.
Right.
So we would have ping pong matches, which I can beat him pretty bad in ping pong. So I would say, how many points I beat you by, you got to give me in cornhole. Well, there was times I've beat him by 17, 18 points, and you're thinking, I'm going to win in cornhole.
Right.
Well, he gave me 70 points, I still get beat. Now, I closed that, like him, I closed that gap a little bit.
Right.
He is right.
So when the Brosmer boys get together, there's no holds barred.
No. We're still as competitive as we ever were. So.
Right. Yeah. Right. Well, you guys are awesome, and it's great seeing you again. And
it's great getting all of us getting together.
Yeah.
And we appreciate you doing this.
Yeah,
this is,
absolutely.
This is awesome.
It's the 40th reunion here. And, you know, it's – and I was talking to Chapman or Davis or somebody. I said, you know, it's – even though it's been 40 years, it still seems like yesterday.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. I look back at those games, and it's amazing how many plays you can remember. You're like, oh, wait, here, I know what's coming up, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, just because it was that special.
Right.
Yeah. And it meant a lot.
Yeah.
It'll stay with us until the grave.
Yep.
And, you know, we'll watch those games on and off.
Yeah.
Every other year, every couple
you
years.
You get better and better all the time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, guys. Appreciate you.
Hey,
appreciate
you.
All right.
Thanks
David
for
Brosmer,
us
Chris Brosmer, two of the a number of key players on that 1982 championship Castle football team here at the 40th reunion from Castle High School. We're going to take a quick time out here, and we'll come back with some more great stuff. Deon Chester, you remember him, a great running back, and Greg Seibert, a junior defensive tackle. They're going to be joining us here right on the ref on this Labor Day weekend.
Gilkey Chiropractic Clinic is a chiropractic clinic located at 7580 Peachwood Drive in Newburgh, Indiana. They specialize in chiropractic care, active release techniques, physical therapy, massage therapy, therapeutic exercise, and nutrition as a drug-free approach to wellness. Gilkey is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics and wishes all teams great success in the brand new year. Gilkey Chiropractic in Newburgh. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-2997 or visit their website at gilkeychiropractic.com.
Jimmy John's. They'll make your sandwiches exactly the way you want them because you're the one who's eating it. Tasty sandwiches made fresh when you order. Place an online order for pickup or delivery. Order your favorite Jimmy John's sandwiches to cater your next business or special event. Made fresh to order on their fresh baked bread using hand-sliced meats and fresh veggies. They'll feed as few or as many as you need. Party boxes, box lunches, and mini Jimmy's are totally customizable. And don't forget to grab bags of Jimmy chips, buckets of jumbo kosher pickle spears, and chocolate chip or oatmeal raisin cookies for the whole crew. Jimmy John's. Online ordering and freaky fast delivery. Visit your local Jimmy John's today.
Napa Auto Parts is your local auto parts store that stocks auto parts, tools, and equipment, and many other items for heavy-duty trucks, marine, and farming equipment. Located at 4966 Highway 66 East in Newburgh, they are open Monday through Friday from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Saturdays from 8 to 3. They're a big supporters of Castle Athletics and wish the 1982 state football champions a great 40th anniversary and reunion. For further information, hit them up at 812-853-0433 or visit their website at NapaOnline.com.
People's Bank is a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Serving the area for over 125 years, Peoples is committed to solving problems and creating opportunities for each and every one of our customers. Come see us at one of our four locations in Boonville, Newburgh, and our newest branch on North Green River Road in Evansville. Ask about our gold checking account, our Main Street mortgage, or any of our other services. Peoples Bank. Friendly. Hometown. Banking. Online at www.peoplestrust.bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender, NMLS 229852.
The Rooster's Den is your local hometown spot to get all your favorite foods here in Newburgh, Indiana, now open for breakfast and lunch. Located here on Haley Drive, they are open Tuesday through Saturday from 6 a.m. to 2 and Sundays from 7 a.m. to 2. Hey, get all your great stuff, your biscuits and gravy, your waffles, all your great stuff, and they're a proud supporter of Castle Athletics. Rooster's Den offers dine-in or carry-out. Hit them up at 812-706-3555 or visit their website at roostersdennewburgh.com.
Back at Castle High School, the 1982 Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion right here on the ref. Gene Earl here. Hey, glad to have you tonight, folks. Corey Clayton, our great producer, back at the station on this Labor Day weekend 2022. And hope everybody's safe and wherever you're at, having a great weekend. And if you're going to get those smokers going or get with family and all that, enjoy yourself. Get you a big three-day weekend. And for some people that I know, they've got a four-day weekend. But regardless, have a great time. Hey, how about our Castle Reunion Show sponsors? Castle Athletics, Chapman Injury Lawyers, Gilkey Chiro and Sports, Jimmy John's, Lawn Masters of Newburgh, Newburgh Auto Parts, People's Bank, Primetime Pub and Grill, and the Rooster's Den. So we're going to be joined now by Greg Seibert here. He was a junior on that squad. And he's here live with us at Castle High School in the Commons area, and commonly known as the cafeteria. And then Deon Chester, he's giving us a shout-out. He's out there in Champaign, Illinois, and he's going to give us a call in. So, guys, appreciate you calling in. And let me ask you this. Deon, Who were you listening to back in the day, back in 1982? I mean, who was the rock star you were listening to?
Well, not much of a rock star. I was a big Prince guy. I was a big Prince and Michael Jackson guy. So, yeah, it wasn't a lot of rock, but some good music.
Well, and speaking of Michael Jackson, Deon, that was when his career was at its peak. And that was
right.
Greg, I don't know if you remember this, but he released the famous Thriller album, and it sold a record 25 million plus copies at the time. Do you remember that, Greg?
Yeah, my sister was really into Michael Jackson.
Oh, she was.
Yeah, I was more into country.
Good. And I will tell you, Deon, I told a couple guys earlier that gas was $1.22 a gallon back then.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Wow.
But if it was out there right now, I mean, we'd be going everywhere, right?
Most definitely.
But Deon Chester here, he's on the phone with us from the Champaign, Illinois area, and Greg Seibert. And, Deon, I'll start out with you. Of course, you guys were juniors on that team. And I looked at the roster, and actually you guys, there was 19 juniors on that team, Deon, so a pretty good mix of juniors and 15 seniors and 14 sophomores. So you had to feel pretty good about all the players on that team, you know, the young and old, as you were on that journey to that undefeated 14-0 season.
Yes, and I would agree. For most championship teams, no matter the sport, it usually takes a collection of all the players. Very rarely do you get a heavily senior-dominated team. It happens, but we were fortunate enough to have folks in the senior class, the junior class, and the sophomore class that obviously contributed to that 14-0 state championship.
Well, Greg, I mean, you were a junior too. I mean, as far as meshing in with the older guys and all that, how'd that work out for you? Or you were a defensive tackle.
It worked out really good for everybody. There were some of us that excelled in certain positions, and that's where they put us. I can remember at the beginning of the season, at the beginning of practice, I wasn't even being looked at to play varsity. There was a senior in front of me, and just so happened that I was able to work my way up into the position. Deon even started or played a few games along with Chris Brosmer as sophomores on the 81 team. So it goes back that far.
Right. So Deon Chester here, yep, on the phone with us, and Greg Seibert, both the juniors on that team. And, of course, Brosmer, he was a junior. And a number of different players that we've had on here tonight to all play key parts of that 14-0 run there. But Deon, I mean, you look at this season, and you had four shutouts, and, man, the offense was clicking. You came into the state game, you outscored your points 401-76. So you had the big offense going. So, Deon, what was it like playing with Mike Davis? I mean, he's a senior quarterback, and I found this out tonight, that he never lost a game as a quarterback from a sixth grader to his senior year. So, you know, you as an offensive guy, well, you had to be licking your chops playing with a guy like that.
Yes, and I tell you, you know, Mike didn't have a lot of experience going into that year. But one thing I was very impressed with is Mike kind of took me under his wing. Obviously, he knew that, you know, I had the potential to play and possibly start, and I just remember him taking me under his wing, and we had a lot of individual throwing sessions. We had a lot of team throwing sessions prior to that year. I can remember Mike inviting me over to his house, because what he discovered, I mean, he needed to get me acclimated to the guys, and, you know, I was just a young guy with my eyes, you know, bright and bushy and just ready to go, and so he knew that he needed to kind of indoctrinate me into the system, and and get me comfortable. And I really appreciated that about Mike and all those guys.
We're talking with Deon Chester here. And Deon, I mean, I know it's been 40 years ago as we celebrate this 1982 3A state championship. But do you still stay in contact with the guys?
Some of the guys I do. More so guys in my class. It's like when I reached out to Greg a couple years ago, we're both Eagle Scouts. We're both Boy Scouts in the same troop. And I happened to notice that he had an affiliation of one of the scout camps, and I had stayed there with my son and reached out to him, and we connected. I do stay in contact with a lot of the guys, especially when I come home and get a chance to visit.
Greg, come with Greg Seibert here. He's another junior on the team, a defensive tackle, a tough player. I mean, you got your chance. You got into the lineup. But, when you talk to Deon, like this Eagle Scout thing, maybe you get together and see each other. What do you guys talk about, and as far as sharing your memories with each other about Castle football?
It's more about scouts than Castle football, really. Not much about Castle football.
When you run into guys, what do you talk about, Greg, as far as other football players?
Yeah. Well, not just that we're both Eagle Scouts. We started in the same way back when at Den. My mom and his mom were our Den leaders.
Right.
We went through the same pack. We went to the same troop. I left because a troop formed at my church. And, we stayed in contact about scouts more than anything.
Greg Seibert here, he's a defensive tackle. Greg, when did you start playing organized football?
Fourth grade.
Fourth grade. Deon, what about you?
I started in fifth grade. My mother, my fourth grade year, accidentally, which I know was on purpose, took me to the wrong place for signups. She did not want me playing football, and so... she said that, sorry, you need to wait till next year. So I started in the fifth grade.
Well, and as you were bonding and so forth, and you were both in the Castle Feeder League, right?
Yeah.
Did you guys kind of feel something special with who you saw coming up and so forth? And I'll start with Greg. As far as the different players here, the seniors, the guys a year ahead of you, and then, of course, you and Deon, was there a sense of something special there?
Really, back then, there was the Newburgh League, and then there was the Chandler League.
Right.
Brosmers and them, they were in the Chandler League. Deon, myself, a few others were in the Newburgh League. We really didn't mix until we got to... junior high, and then we met junior high and started to form the clique, so to speak. And then back in the days back then, the Castle program from high school went down to the junior high, so we were already being prepped for the positions they wanted us to play in high school back then. So that's when we melted.
Right, Deon?
Well, I think what I remember is just the being in the Newburgh League. It wasn't about preparation or getting ready for, joining junior high. It was all about winning to get to the Super Bowl, the JFL Super Bowl. Everybody wanted to win. It was a big deal that you got to play at the high school for the championship game. But I remember, there were some tough battles and at fifth and sixth grade level just to be able to compete at that final game in the Castle Stadium.
Well, and Greg, of course, Deon went on to Ball State, had a great career there, Deon, and there for a while you were like the all timer there. I think you might be. You're still up there in the top two or three, but
Greg, do you remember following Deon at Ball State whenever he started playing some college ball?
I watched, I listened, I read the newspapers about it. Yeah. I didn't contact him back then. I was dealing with, I got hurt in wrestling, so I was trying to get myself back into shape. I went to U of E and just couldn't cut it anymore.
Right. Deon, what did you take from yourself, you know, playing for Coach Lighty and all the great coaches here at Castle when you went to have that great career there at Ball State?
A lot of what I took with me is just that hard-nosed winning attitude, being a team player, you know, fighting, scrapping for your position. To be able to start, I ended up starting as a freshman, and it wasn't easy. I think every day in preseason, I probably was in a fight, and a literal fight, just trying to, you know, find my way. But it was just that tough, hard-nosed attitude, that winning attitude that we all had. I mean, we all had that attitude that we were going to win. We didn't think about losing, didn't talk about losing. We talked about winning, and me going to college, I knew I had to take that with me, and I had talked to the coaches, and I said, I want to play. I didn't want to sit the bench my freshman year, and they said, you come to Ball State, you'll have the opportunity to prove it, and that's what I did.
And you guys went, of course, the undefeated season in 82, 14-0, then in 83, you guys were 11-1, so you guys went like 25-1 in 2 years, your junior senior year, and it's I can see, and we're losing Deon wasn't even in the conversation.
Well, it's just like what you had mentioned with Mike Davis. We were kind of the same way. Now he went back to sixth grade, but when we got to when we came together as a group at the seventh grade level, our group as a team, we never lost a game either. So 2 years of junior high and 4 years of high school, we lost our very last football game our senior year. So that, you know, that was a heck of a run we had. It was a shame we had to end that way, but I took a lot of that with me to Ball State.
All right. Well, listen, guys, Deon, we're going to have to run here. We got a football game here. We got to get on tonight. But
all right.
Appreciate you guys and. It's good to catch up, Greg, and Deon, of course, in the Champaign, Illinois area, and 40 years. And I was telling Neil Chapman earlier, I've watched the game like twice myself already, and it seems like it was like yesterday. But certainly you guys gave us a lot of great memories here in the Southern Indiana as everybody here in this area was behind that team as you went on to beat Hobart there 26-23. So appreciate you guys. And, Deon, have a great night and a great Labor Day weekend. And, Greg, good to have you, brother.
Glad to be here.
All right. There you go, folks, the last two guests here. And Deon Chester and Greg Seibert. And what a great night here that we've had at the Castle High School cafeteria, the 40th reunion of the 1982 Castle State Football Championship team on the ref here. And I think this is like my fourth special that I've had. I had the U of E basketball special from 1989. I had the modern day football 2000 state champs special show on that. And then Coach Locke here about a year and a half ago, his, I think, 2021, his 2001 state championship 20-year reunion on the softball side. And so now we're back here again at Castle High School. And Coach Locke here certainly played a big part in helping me get all these guests together. And actually, Pat Locke here was the Phil N. Eskew Mental Attitude Award winner, but a bunch of All-Staters, David Brosmer, Matt McDowell, Rodney Russell, Chris Brosmer, Deon Chester, Mike Davis, Joe Huff, and Pat Lockyer. But just a great bunch of guys who were committed to being the best they can be. So I want to thank Corey Clayton, back at the station. And this is Gene Worrell saying, hey, thanks for listening in to a trip down memory lane. This has been the 1982 Castle State Football Championship 40th reunion right here on the REF ESPN Radio. Thanks for listening in.